ओम नमः शिवाय। श्रीपाद श्रीवल्लभ चरितामृतम। चैप्टर टू। शंकर भट्ट मीट्स श्री सिद्धेंद्र योगी एंड द स्टोरी ऑफ विचित्रापुरम। आई शंकर भट्ट वॉज रिकलेक्टिंग द स्ट्रेंज एक्सपीरियंसेस इन मरुत्वामलई एंड कंटिन्यूड माई जर्नी वाइल मेंटली चैंटिंग द ग्लोरियस नेम ऑफ श्रीपाद श्रीवल्लभ। I visited many holy places on the way. I was getting food without soliciting anyone for it. This was a rare experience. I felt that weight of my body was gradually coming down when I reached the Kadamba forest in the Pandya kingdom. There was a Shivalinga of great power. After visiting Ishwara there, my legs became very heavy. I rested for some time in that Shiva's temple and resumed the journey. I found a hermitage nearby. There lived a great person called Sri Siddhendra Yogi. When I prostrated to his lotus feet, my body became lighter than a cotton ball. I was conscious of my body feeling, but the weight of my body had almost become nil. That great preceptor with a merciful heart stroked my head and blessed me, saying, "May you have the darshan of Sripada Srivallabha." That great yogi explained, "My son Shankar Bhatt, the Shivalinga which you have seen is very powerful. In ancient times, Devendra conquered many demons, but one of them escaped. He was doing penance. Indra killed ruthlessly that Rakshasa while he was in the tapas penance. Indra lost his luster because of his sin in killing one doing tapas. Indra visited many holy places for absolution from the sin. As the Shivalinga in the Kadamba forest of Pandya kingdom was very powerful, all the sins of Indra were removed suddenly when Indra reached Kadamba forest. He wondered at it with the idea that there was something special and great. He searched the place in all directions. He found a Shivalinga. Indra worshipped that Shivalinga with devotion and constructed a temple for that self-manifested Shivalinga. So that was a Shivalinga consecrated by Indra. That Shivalinga removes all sins and confers all auspiciousness. People with great punya, virtuous merit can only see that Shivalinga. But for the devotees of Lord Datta, meeting with pious people and visiting holy places will take place unasked for and without any effort. I again bowed to the lotus feet of Sri Siddhendra Yogi. He asked me to go for the Shivalinga again. When I went there for the second time, I found a beautiful temple of Shiva that was not the temple which I visited previously. When I inquired, I learnt that it was the temple of Sri Meenakshi and Sundareshwarar and that I was in the town of Mathura. I visited the deities and went to the hermitage of Sri Siddhendra Yogi afterwards. The whole area appeared as a thickly populated township. However much I searched, I could not find the hermitage of the Yogindra. Recollecting the holy name of Sripad Srivallabha, I was going random in some direction. The sun set started. It was getting dark. I saw a focus of light coming from rear side. When I turned back, I saw a big serpent with three hoods following me. There were three diamonds on those three hoods. Brilliant light emitted from those diamonds. I was struck with fear. Whenever I stopped, the serpent was also stopping. The divine name of Sripada was welling up from the depth of my bosom involuntarily. Similarly, the holy name of Sripada was being uttered from my mouth involuntarily. At last I reached the ashram of Sri Siddha Yogindra. Immediately the divine serpent and the light disappeared. Sri Siddha Yogindra treated me with utmost compassion. He gave me fried chickpeas in a plantain leaf as prasad. I ate bellyful. The palpitation of my heart did not decrease even though I was taking food. Sri Siddha Yogindra massaged my right breast lightly with love. Afterwards, he touched my head with his holy hand. I noticed the slowing down of palpitation of the heart. I also felt as if some foul gases were purged out of my lungs. I also experienced that all bad thoughts and cruel desires were pushed out of my mind. My body temperature increased and I was in a state of stupor. The greatness of Datta and the qualifications required for obtaining the grace of Sripada. Then Sri Siddha Yogindra stated as following, Shankar Bhatta, the Sivalinga which you saw at first, and Sri Sundareshwara whom you visited later are not different. Sri Dattatreya ordered that you should be provided with this kind of experience. So it was granted to you accordingly. That means that time was rolled back and the Shivalinga established by Indra and the actual surroundings existed at that time were shown to you. To regard the creation which you witness as real creation is Maya, illusion. Everything is embodiment of consciousness. By the will of Lord Datta, future may become present. The consciousness of Lord Datta is eternal present. Whatever happened in the past and whatever is happening at present and whatever is to happen in the future will occur according to the will of Lord Datta. The resolve of Lord Datta is essential for an event to happen, not to happen or to happen in a different novel way. Sri Dattatreya is the personification of that magnificent determination responsible for the creation, sustenance and liquidation. Now he has taken birth on this earth as Sripada Srivallabha. The residents of Pithapuram did not recognize him properly. They failed to understand the philosophy of a guru. In Kuruvapuram, even ignorant persons like fishermen obtained knowledge of Brahman. To get the grace of Sripada Srivallabha, the ahamkara, arrogance within us has to be destroyed. All types of pride are to become extinct. Then only we can understand his power, his mercy and his real nature. A merchant named Dhananjaya found the Shivalinga consecrated by Indra and informed the matter to the ruler King Sekhara Pandya. Following the command of Shiva, Kulashekhara Pandya developed it and built a town there. He named it Mathurai. His son Malayadhvaja Pandya conducted a sacrifice called Putra Kameshti for obtaining progeny. From the altar of that sacrifice, a three-year-old baby girl emerged as one not born out of womb. She is Meenakshi Devi. She married Sundareshwarar. The Vegavati river, born out of the matted hair of Shiva, is sanctifying Mathura town. Mahavishnu himself donated the bridge to the bridegroom and organized the divine marriage of Meenakshi and Sundareshwarar in a very grand scale. Sri Siddha Yogindra had added, my son Shankar Bhatta, vibrations emanate from every article in the creation. On account of these variegated vibrations, attraction and repulsion takes place. With other things, in the gross, subtle and mortal fleshly bodies, good vibrations due to good deeds and bad vibrations due to sinful acts arise. On account of meritorious virtue, desire for meeting pious persons, visiting holy places and interest in righteous deeds will increase. Thereby, the virtuous merit gets enhanced. Unless that virtue increase and sin diminish, we cannot have steady devotion towards Lord Datta. Variety of incidents happen owing to time, accumulated merit or demerit or other causes. You could come here only on account of the boundless compassion of Sri Vallabha on you. I was wondering at my extreme fortune and becoming excited in my mind. I was eager to reach Kuruvapuram and I decided not to leave the holy feet of Sri Vallabha. When I woke up the next morning, I was subjected to amazement and astonishment because I was lying at the base of an Audumbara tree, the very sacred Indian fig tree, on a hillock. There was no movement of people in the surroundings. Was my stay during night in the hermitage of Sri Siddhendra Yogi merely a hallucination? Was Sri Siddhendra Yogi a cheat, a magician or a devil? Such doubts crept in my mind. The words of Sri Siddha Yogendra about Lord Sri Datta were resounding in my ears. I wondered as to what was it would be for Sripada Srivallabha to keep me in such a predicament. Many thoughts were crossing in my mind. I collected my belongings and resumed my journey. My journey continued from morning till noon. I saw a village having small houses. The pangs of hunger increased and troubled me. I am a Brahmin and can take meals only in the house of Brahmins. I cannot take meals elsewhere. I thought of preparing the meals myself if someone provides the materials. Then I can eat such food. I got a doubt whether any Brahmins were living in the village. So I asked some villagers about it. One of them said, "Sir, we are a hill tribe. I am the chief of this hamlet. There are no Brahmins in our village. We can accept fruits and honey from you can accept fruits and honey from us if you have no objection. There is an adage that one can behave like a low caste Sudra on the way during travels. Therefore, I considered that it was not wrong to accept anything offered by anybody in the course of travel. They placed before me fruits and honey from ant hills available in those ravines. When I was about to eat, a crow came from somewhere and started pecking me on my head. I tried to drive it away, but in vain. In the meanwhile, some more crows gathered. They started pecking my body in all spots in a wanton manner. I was panic-stricken and began to run. Those crows were chasing me. There was no one in that village who could help me. The chief of the village spoke, 'Oh, what a strange thing. In our area, crows do not harm anyone. We wonder why these crows are so ferocious and obstinate to harm you. You must have abused a Siddha Purusha or dishonored him. You are undergoing this punishment because of his curse. If we are to obstruct the course of punishment, we have to incur the wrath of that sage. So we will not try to change the course of divine play. Please do not misunderstand us.' After saying this, the chief kept quiet. I could not take the fruits and honey given to me. My body became blood-stained. The crows chased and injured me even though I was running. I felt extremely sad at my dismal state. Has Sri Siddha Yogendra cursed me because I doubted him? But he had blessed me that I would have the fortune of seeing Sripada Srivallabha. Probably I could not have the darshan of Lord Sri Datta unless all my sins accumulated from past births are completely destroyed. I do not know how many sinful deeds I had amassed. How many punishments like this I have to suffer if all those sins are to be washed out. Oh, are so many difficulties and dangers involved in the blessings bestowed for the darshan of Sri Vallabha? Oh God, still how many punishments you want to inflict on me? Now who can save me? Sripada Sri Vallabha, save me. Sharanu Sharanu, Sripada Sri Vallabha." With such thoughts of absolute surrender, I slowly reached the root portion of an Audumbara tree. I thought that the Audumbara tree, which is the residing center of Lord Sri Dattatreya, would protect me. But the sport of Lord Sri Datta ran contrary to my hope. An unpredicted foul smell was spreading from my body. Attracted by that odious odor or by the frowny of fate, big poisonous snakes were coming in a row quickly. They were biting me and leaving quickly. I was troubled by crows before. Now my entire body became poisonous because of bites from venomous snakes. Foam was coming out of my mouth. The strength of my heart began to decline. I thought that I was sure to die at any moment. It was evening dusk. Some washermen were going that way. They washed, dried and bundled the dried clothes. They kept the bundles on the backs of donkeys and were going. They noticed my miserable plight, but they hesitated to touch me for some time because I was a Brahmin. As delay might endanger my life, they regarded saving life was of prime importance. Hence, they seated me on a donkey and took me to their village. For me, all troublesome incidents were taking place in a procession on that day. The washerman took me to the colony of cobblers. One of those tanners had knowledge of medicine relating to poison. They kept me on a cot, the bottom of which was laced with cords of ticken. The premises was full of bad smell. That cobbler physician made juice of some wild herbs. He made me drink that juice. He tied some leaves on the points where snakes had bitten me. He plucked some tender leaves from an odumbara tree. Juice like milk was flowing from those leaves. He kept stems of those leaves in my 2 ears. I was getting terrible pain. I tried to get up and run away. 2 strong men held me firmly. I was helpless. That physician instructed his assistants, "The poison will come into the odumbara leaves. After that, you have to burn those poisonous leaves. The man will cry much louder as the poison increasingly gets transformed to the odumbara leaves. So you hold him firmly." After some time, the poison was neutralized. I became healthy. I stayed in the house of the cobbler all throughout the night. The skin tanner was singing during the whole night, "Datta Digambara, Datta Digambara, Sripada Vallabha Datta Digambara." I was lying on the cot. My heart swelled. On hearing the extremely melodious names of the Lord. My love for the cobbler enhanced because he became my co-disciple of our Guru due to the spiritual relationship. In the next moment, I was pained with the realization that I was born in a superior Brahmin caste and that he was a low caste cobbler. The teaching of a cobbler called Vallabha Das to Shankar Bhatt. After completing the singing, the cobbler came to me. The compassion was overflowing from his eyes. His 2 eyes were suggesting the experience of self. A doubt crept in my mind whether he was some yogi. He turned to me and said, "Sir, my name is Vallabha Dasu. I am an artisan doing work with the hides of animals. I was born in a low caste. There is no doubt about it. Nevertheless, I want to tell you some information. I already knew that your name is Shankar Bhatt and that you are traveling to visit Sripada Srivallabha. Not only that, I also know why you are harassed by crows and snakes on the way." I was astonished. I thought that probably he made some study of astrology and acquired some proficiency in the subject. Vallabha Das said immediately, "Sir, I am not an astrologer. Sri Kshetra Pithapuram is the birthplace of great scholars. It is the holy place where Sangha Vedartha Samrat Pandit, an emperor in the Vedic lore, Malladi Bapanavadhani actually lived. The Vedas, while attempting to describe the Supreme Being, became tired in the process. They could not pinpoint the phenomenon correcting and simply ruled out everything, saying, 'This is not, this is not.' Such is the nature of Supreme Being. Pithapuram is the sacred place where that supreme phenomenon is born as Sripada Srivallabha. Dry philosophy and meaningless debates cannot earn the grace of Sripada Srivallabha. There is no need for scholarly excellence to obtain the mercy of Sripada. On the other hand, pedantic pride will throw us far away from him. The crows that pecked at you were great pandits who lived in Pithapuram during their previous lives. They could not recognize the divine nature of Sri Vallabha, that they could not realize him as Lord Datta. Thus they wasted their whole lives. They could recite Vedas upside down, but what use? They were repeating words like Krama, Granth, Ghana, Jata, Swadha, and exhibiting their arrogance. After death, they went to heaven. Indra praised them. He showered praise on them, saying, "Oh, you are Kramantha, you are Ghanapati, you are Jati, oh, you are an expert in Tarka argument. What a fortune! How many hundreds and thousands of times you have recited Veda! What a merit, what a merit! Only because of that merit, you could step into Swarga." All the denizens of Indraloka admired them sky high. However, these pandits suffered the pangs of hunger. Divine ambrosia was available in heaven. They heard that one is fed from hunger and thirst by drinking it. These people directly submitted their problem to Indra, as none paid any heed to them. To that Indra replied, "Veda is the form of Lord's inhalation and exhalation. Lord is infinite and deathless. Therefore, Vedas are also infinite. Vedas are the basis for all dharmas, ethical principles. By chanting Vedas, you have praised the Lord. As a reward for it, we the Celestials are always praising you highly. Otherwise, is it possible for you to get encomiums from me? If one desires food, he must provide food to others. If one donates a grain, we the celestial enhance it to 1,000 grains and return them to the donor as a reward. When you have not donated anything, how can we help? Because of your Vedic recitation, you derived immense benefit. Therefore, you can reside freely in Indraloka as long as it exists. Afterwards, you can go to another world. In this way, you can remain eternally free. Those who heard the words of Indra faced a difficult situation. It occurred to them that to live eternally without food and suffer prolonged hunger and thirst was indeed an unbearable punishment. Indra said again, "You lived in the holy Padagaya Kshetra, but you performed annual ceremonies to manes of your ancestors without care and concern. You were always calculating the expenditure incurred for such functions. You were also absorbed in the thought that you were eating delicious food items, but you were devoid of care and devotion required for the performance of these solemn ceremonies. As a result, your forefathers did not attain noble positions after their death. Your heirs were also behaving like that. Your children also did lament that you lived too long and a large amount of money was wasted on medical facilities provided to you. They even wondered, oh, how much food was wasted. Sriman Narayana himself incarnated as Sripada Srivallabha in the midst of you. When he was showing the way for salvation, you abused him. You indulged in fruitless arguments and counter-arguments. Even though all the auspicious traits like omnipresence, omniscience, omnipotence and qualities of an incarnation were clearly visible, you became blind people who could not recognize Sripada Srivallabha as an avatar of Sri Datta. It is ordained that you remain as crows in the forms of the manes of your ancestors till you drink the blood of a person whose body was purified by the chanting of the sacred name of Sripada Srivallabha. Sri Vallabhadas said, Shankara Bhatta, it was for this reason they were born as crows, and on account of their previous merit they drank your blood and obtained noble status. Then I noted that Vallabhadas was not an ordinary person and that the grace of Sripada Srivallabha was completely on him. Sri Vallabha Das added, Sir, the serpents who were attracted by the scent emanating from your body attained salvation. I said, Sir, great Vallabhadas ji, why should this incident take place? If my body were to be used as food for crows, serpents and other living creatures, it would be a harrowing experience for me. I am under constant fear of being attacked by any creature at any time. Sri Vallabhadas said, Sir, this is all a sportive play of Sripada. Do not have such fear. Such incidents would not take place in future. Only the one who gives life will have the authority to take out life. Therefore, such authority is not vested in anyone except God. However, some of your ancestors worshipped Goddess Kali of the burial ground. With the help of that mantra, they killed many persons whom they disliked. They earned great sin because they were responsible for the unnatural deaths of those people. Due to that sin, they took birth as snakes. But as you were also born in their family, you were all blood relations. Moreover, you obtained the mercy of Sripada. Because of this small merit, this incident took place and they got salvation. A Brahmin should be a seeker of truth. A Kshatriya should be bound by Dharma. A Vyasa should attend to cultivation, protection of cattle, skilled sale and purchase activities. Therefore, he should be a calm person. A Sudra should be a loving one and render services. Even then, there is no distinction between caste, creed, rich and poor for the grant of divine grace. A Brahmin can follow the duty of a Kshatriya and can become a king. When a Kshatriya desires knowledge of Brahman, he can adopt the duty of a Brahmin. Had not Kusuma Shreshti, who was a Vyasa, chose Kshatriya Dharma and became a ruler, according to Brahmanic Dharma, killing an enemy is sinful, but In Kshatriya Dharma, it is a prescribed duty. You are a Brahmin and a seeker of truth. Therefore, non-violence is a supreme duty for you, but not for a butcher. So, if a man wants to get proper results from his actions, he should perform the duties according to the dharma adopted by him, irrespective of the caste to which he belongs. As you are at present ill, it is desirable and necessary that you should be with a doctor. That is why you are brought to me. Please note that Sripada Srivallabha will observe us every moment. In your childhood, you were reciting the prayers about Lord Vishnu. You were prattling with your friends in a funny manner. It is indeed a prayer of Lord Ganesha. For the words in the sloka, Suklam Baradharam Vishnum Sashivarnam Chaturbhujam Prasanna Vadanam Dhyayet Sarva Vignopa Shantaye. You are giving a perverted interpretation for the sake of fun. You were giving the following meaning, Suklam Baradharam, that which bear white clothes. Vishnum means that which is everywhere. Sashivarnam means white ash colored. Chaturbhujam, four legged instead of four hands. Prasanna Vadanam, the donkey will have a gracious face when it bays. The donkey will kick people with its hind legs is the meaning given. Dhyayet, so it is face is only pleasant to look at. Sarva Vignopa Shantaye, I pray for abatement of all obstacles. In this way you were jokingly giving a perverse meaning to that holy prayer and extended its meaning as a prayer applicable to an donkey. Shankara Bhatta, Lord Datta, is a skilled one. The Lord would rectify the mistakes also made by you for fun in his presence. The washerman brought you to me on a donkey. At that time you were covered with dust and bore an ashen color. You came here with halting pace and sometimes you walked on all your fours, two legs and two hands, supporting yourself on your hands placed on the ground. Even though you came to the Audumbara tree on all your four, gasping for breath, you could not avoid the accident. Your hope of escaping from the serpents in this way was bullied. You had a placid countenance if you do not convulse with pain. At last you were brought to the village of cobblers. In subjecting you to so many miseries, Sripada provided entertainment and taught you a lesson. Those tanners were freed from their ignoble births. You were teaching the prayer sloka of Sri Vishnu to your friends in jocular manner. That is the reason why you have come to a position where you have to bear the teachings of a low caste person like me. Now you are here. Tomorrow you may stay in the house of your own caste people. If you disclose this incident even by mistake, they will ostracize you. With the good teaching of Sri Vallabha Das, the Brahmanic arrogance in me decreased. The feeling disappeared that Vallabha Das was a pariah. He had brotherly love for him. I had brotherly love for him as if he was my blood relation. I accepted the hospitality of Vallabha Das for 2 or 3 days and left the village afterwards. What can I describe about the mercy of Sri Vallabha? I was involved in very strange circumstances in a town called Vichitrapuram and came out in a strange way. When I was going on foot from Vichitrapuram, some royal servants approached me with humble obedience and inquired whether I was a Vaishnava or a Shaiva. I told them that we were Smarthas who observe no distinction between Shiva and Keshava, but we show some inclination towards Shaivism, and that the pontiff of Southern Monastery, Sri Sringeri Shankaracharya, was our preceptor. They requested me to visit their king. I went with them for the royal audience. On the way, I understood some peculiar matters. That king was inviting any Brahman who was seen on the day and questioning, "Is this much is for that much? Is this much is for that much? How much will be for this much?" No one could give a satisfactory answer to that question. That king conducted a sacrifice some years back to beget sons. Fortunately, he got a son. However, From that day, Brahmins faced peculiar troubles. As the son born to the king became a mute, the king was of the opinion that because of the defective sacrifice performed by Brahmins, his son became dumb. Therefore, the king got the heads of Shaivite Brahmins completely shaved, marked three faces with the paint of vertical Vaishnava lines and paraded them on the back of donkeys. Likewise, he got the heads of Vaishnava Brahmins cleanly shaved, marked their faces with horizontal lines made of holy ash and paraded them seated on the backs of donkeys. This situation became unbearable to both Shaivas and Vaishnavas. The king suddenly began to behave in an peculiar fashion. He was donating Totakura, green leafy vegetable, liberally to the Brahmins. He ordered that Totakura should be cultivated in large acreage of the cultivated land. He was collecting half of the taxes in the form of Totakura. Cartloads of Totakura were collected and kept in the fort. Totakura was donated in very large quantities and Brahmins could not consume it fully. Cooking of rice and eating of other victuals were forbidden for the Brahmins. After eating cooked Totakura in the main meal, they had to eat cooked or uncooked Totakura as a tiffin. What can the poor Brahmins do? All the Brahmins who took great pride as scholars in logic, scholars in philosophy, and scholars in Puranas shed their arrogance and were praying God silently and pitiably to redress their evil plight. There was a devotee of Datta who was an ardent follower of Datta cult among the Brahmins. He told that Lord Dattatreya becomes merciful at mere remembrance and the Lord only can remove their miserable condition. Therefore, all the Brahmins observed Mandala Diksha, a spiritual discipline for 40 days and started worshipping Lord Dattatreya. As his son was dumb, the king wanted to encourage the language for the dumb. He instructed the Raja Guru, preceptor of the king, to write a book on the language of the dumb. That preceptor of the royal court was formerly very haughty. Then he was in a very miserable state and undertook extensive research in the mute language. The discussion between Shankar Bhatta and Maharaja. I was taken before the king. I was perspiring profusely. I thought about how much rigorous test Sripad Srivallabha imposed upon me. I was mentally chanting the name of Sripad without any pause. I was getting courage which I did never possess before. The king posed the same question which he asked all the people. He asked me, if that much becomes this much, how much this much becomes? I replied solemnly, this much only, for this much. The king was taken aback and said, Mahatma, you are great. I became blessed on seeing you. Only recently I had recollection of the knowledge about my past lives. I was a very poor Brahmin in my previous birth. I was growing Totakura in my house. I was offering it freely to all those who asked for it. The Brahmins who received it from me were all wealthy and did not suffer from want of food and water. They simply took the vegetable gratis from me but did not cooperate with me on any day. They did not show any mercy on me. Whatever they were deputing me on their behalf for annual ceremonies of ancestors or for marriages, the householders used to give me large amounts of money and presents. Out of this, the people who were deputing me were snatching 99% and releasing 1% for me. Labor was mine and reward was theirs. In addition, they were getting free supply of Totakura from my house. I was suffering from acute poverty, but continued to donate Totakura as usual. Those Brahmins were telling that the vegetable was very tasty and no harm would happen by eating it daily. The circle of time rotated swiftly. As I was donating Totakura in spite of my abject poverty, I was born as a king in this birth. Those Brahmins who received that green vegetable from me took birth as Brahmins in my kingdom. In this way, I was born many times richer and greater than them. By donating Totakura, I became a king. So I am donating greater quantities of that vegetable in cartloads. So I am asking everyone, what would be the magnificent state I would achieve in future as a result of my present donations. You only gave a correct answer to my peculiar question. The king concluded his speech. Then I explained, Raja, Tottakura was very valuable under the circumstances of your previous life, but considering your present exalted position, its value is negligible. Being in a position to donate diamonds, precious stones and gold, you are still donating Tottakura. So however much you donate that green leafy vegetable, you cannot get anything more except 100 times of that Tottakura. The king was very much pleased with my reply. It gave great relief to my mind that for a casual reply of mine, the king gave an account of his previous life. I felt that owing to the great grace of Sripada, the dishonor of riding an ass was avoided. I had already mounted a donkey for interpretation of the sacred verse Suklam Bharadaram Vishnu for fun in my childhood. I offered salutations in my mind to Sripada, who saved me from riding an ass in a disgraceful condition. Then started the second test. The test was held in the language of the dumb, which was very much dear to the king. The Rajaguru began to examine me. Showing his fingers, the Rajaguru questioned me with signs whether it was one or two. I thought that he was asking me whether I came alone or I was accompanied by anyone. I replied with signs, showing one finger, that I came singly. Then he showed me three fingers that suggested to me about Lord Dattatreya. I assumed that he was inquiring whether I was a devotee of Datta. I felt that devotion should be kept as a secret. So I showed a closed fist and conveyed the message that it was a secret matter which belonged to innermost heart. Further, the Rajaguru offered sweets, requesting me with gestures to accept. I refused to accept and I showed a pack of parched rice. I took some flattened rice from the bundle and gave them. My idea was that I liked flattened rice more than sweets and they could also partake them. Then the Rajaguru in a profound voice prayed, Raja, he is a great Pandit. It is known that he is the great Vedic scholar who mastered all Vedas. He is a great expert in the sign language of the deaf. All of this was perplexing to me. Then Rajaguru told the king, Raja, I asked him whether Shiva and Keshava are one or they are different. Showing one finger, he said that both are one. I showed him through fingers, indicating that Trinity, Brahma, Vishnu and Maheshwara could exist differently. He replied by showing his fist closed and questioned, are not the five fingers of the hands exist collectively as one? I offered him sweetmeats, requesting him to accept me as his disciple. Thereupon he indicated that he is not bothered with disciples and that he leads a contented life with Kuchela. Saying so, he turned down my request and gave me parched and flattened rice. I was astonished. Oh, I wondered how vastly varied are the methods of understanding minds and thoughts in the world. Then the third and final exam. Rajaguru was reading the mantras from Rudra Chamaka, verses from Rudradhyaya, invoking the blessings of Rudra for grant of various desires, and wanted me to explain their meaning. Remembering Sri Vallabha, I began to expatiate their meaning according to my perfunctory knowledge. Ekachame means one. Trirachame means number three added to previous one. It is four, and its mathematical root is two. Panchachame is addition of five to the previous arrived four, that gives nine, and its mathematical root is three. Saptachame signifies the addition of seven to the already arrived number nine. The total is 16 and the root of it is 4. Navachame means adding 9 to the already derived number 16. The total works out of 25 and the root is 5. Ekadasachame involves addition of 11 to the number 25 already worked out. The total is 36 and its root is 6. Trayodasachame, in addition to the 13 to previous 36. The total comes to 49 and its mathematical root is 7. Panchadasachame means additions 15 to the number 49. The total is 64 and its root is 8. Saptachame is 17 plus 64 is equal to 81 and the mathematical root is 9. The other factors are as follows. Navadasachame means 19 plus 81 is equal to 100. Its root is 10. Eka vingsatis chame. 21 plus 100 is equal to 120. Its root is 11. Trivingsatis chama. 23 plus 121 is equal to 144. Its root is 12. Pancha vingsati chama. 25 plus 144 is equal to 169. Its root is 13. Sapta vingsati chama. 27 plus 169 is equal to 196. Its root is 14. Navavim sati chama. 29 plus 196 is equal to 225. Its root is 15. Eka triyamshati chame is equal to 31 plus 225 is equal to 256. Its root is 16. The above details are shown in the following way for better understanding. Eka chama means 101 plus 000 is equal to 001. Its root is 1. Trisha chama means 03 plus 001 is equal to 004. Its root is 02. Pancha chame is equal to 05 plus 004 is equal to 009. Its root is 3. Sapta chame 07 plus 009 is equal to 016. Its root is 04. Nava chame 09 plus 016 is equal to 025. Its root is 05. Eka dasa chame 11 plus 025 is equal to 036. Its root is 6. Trayodasa chame is equal to 13 plus 036 is equal to 049. Its root is 7. Panchadasa chame 15 plus 049 is equal to 064. Its root is 08. Saptadasa chame 17 plus 064 is equal to 081. Its root is 09. Navadasa chame 19 plus 081 is equal to 100. Its root is 10. Eka vingsati chame 21 plus 100 is equal to 121. Its root is 11. Trayo vingsati chame 23 plus 121 is equal to 144. Its root is 12. Pancha vingsati chame 25 plus 144 is equal to 169. Its root is 13. Sapta vingsatis chame 27 plus 169 is equal to 196. Its root is 14. Nava vingsatis chame 29 plus 196 is equal to 225. Its root is 15. Eka triyam satis chame 31 plus 225 is equal to 256. Its root is 16. I explained in the foregoing manner the mathematical mysteries enshrined in the Vedic mantras of Rudra Chamaka. The above explanation brings to light the mathematical genius of our ancestors. Modern concepts of arithmetical progression, geometric progression, and other scientific formula are to be found in the Vedic texts translator. My explanation was highly appreciated by the scholars in the court. I was amazed at my own explanation. Again, I added, all this is about the mystery of atoms responsible for creation. This was known to sage Kanada. Various metals form according to the different arrangements of the number of atoms. On account of the great mercy of Sripada Srivallabha, I came out of the Vichitrapura in a strange way in the above manner. Victory, victory unto Sripada Srivallabha. Chapter 2 completed.